Is this their final resting place? These rusting remnants of man's greatest ambitions? Once they roamed freely across an uncharted America, snorting, charging man-made horses of iron, giving coast-to-coast access to a nation of purposeful wanderers. Now they stand silent, mute evidence of the passage of time, of the transience of power, of diminishing usefulness. They are the historical residue of a mechanical revolution that dominated and directed the evolution of modern American culture. Huffing and puffing their way to a position of prominence among humanity's most imaginative achievements, these were machines destined to be larger than life icons, the heavyweight champions of transport, in an era when all good things seemed possible, when the biggest of dreams were within reach. But this is not the end for these marvelous creations. This is the storage yard of the California State Railroad Museum in Sacramento, California. And this is the first step on the way to total restoration of these relics. This is the Inyo. She sure is a real beauty. She's also a movie star, but I'll tell you about that later. Because right now she's about to go on stage in the greatest show of her career. Hi, I'm Hoyt Axton, and welcome to Railfare 91. You're just in time for the start of the festivities.
I want to thank you for coming today. I know you're going to enjoy Railfare. And as my last act up here, it's my privilege to declare Railfare open.
Let's go see some of the greatest trains of all time. Board! August 25th, 1830, a tiny steam engine generating just one single horsepower and appropriately nicknamed Tom Thumb struggled mightily to pull a small carload of passengers over a seven-mile stretch of track near Baltimore, Maryland. The first ever rail commute. America became a nation of travelers. May 10th, 1869, the United States was joined together by a band of steel. America became a nation of entrepreneurs. By 1910, more than 1.5 million Americans worked on the railroads. America had become a nation of industry. By 1950, America had more than 50,000 steam engines. America was the most powerful nation on Earth. And now it is May the 3rd, 1991. The greatest ever collection of significant railroad equipment has converged for a once-in-a-lifetime event for Railfare 91. America relives the spirit.
Now this is more my style. It's hot in some of those old steam engines, as pretty as they were. This is the Northern Pride, owned by Bill Gardner, who was kind enough to lend it to me for Railfare. The Northern Pride is one of the youngest trains here at Railfare 91. If you'd like to see the oldest, well, we got to go back 170 years.
It's an unusual engine because it's what we call the last of the colliery type engines. There have been, this is probably about the original, is probably about the 20th locomotive that was built. Because the history of steam locomotives goes back to 1803. The engine itself is rather peculiar because it's got a lot of sort of knitting up on top of the boiler, with vertical cylinders working upwards and side rods which come downwards onto the wheels. But it's a great machine. It works beautifully.
The original pulled the world's first passenger train. This was built in 1975 to celebrate the 150th anniversary of that event.
As you can see, it's had a lot of use. It's a good design, it works well. It now looks suitably oily and used and looks as real as the original. The original still exists, that's at Darlington in England. And it's quite a comparison. But this really gives you an idea of what an engine was like in the early 19th century. And this is 5 years before the first English engine was brought to America when your railway started.
It wasn't long before this new invention found its way to America.
The Tom Thumb is a replica of what was actually the first locomotive in the United States. The original Peter Cooper's engine built in 1830, this Tom Thumb replica built in 1926, it appeared in the B&O's Fair of the Iron Horse in 1927. It's been in several hundred exhibitions, fairs, promotions ever since. Last fired up in 1987, we gave it a complete restoration to bring it out here to Rail Fair, which for us was quite a treat.
The replica is larger than the original Tom Thumb, which weighed about a ton and had cylinders 3 inches by 14 inches.
Technically, it would be a 022. It's a small vertical boiler locomotive, very typical of early American practice. Right now it weighs about 13,000 pounds. So nearly as we can tell, develops about 3/4 of a horsepower. It can barely get itself over the road, much less pull a long train. But this, like the original, was a demonstration piece. It's got a tiny little 4-inch bore cylinder, a mystery valve gear. We're still not sure how it works, much less what kind of valve gear it has. But it's very sparing on coal. We could probably go 20 miles on a box of coal and a barrel of water.
The Lafayette, the original Lafayette, was the first locomotive on the B&O with a horizontal boiler, as opposed to the vertical boiler engines that the B&O was so fond of. Even in the 1830s, the B&O was idiosyncratic, somewhat quirky in its choice of motive power. As the first horizontal boiler locomotive, it was a pioneer. It was a demonstration piece for the B&O. They liked it. Used almost its entire life between Baltimore and Washington.
This type of engine was referred to as a one-arm Billy because of its single driver and the designer's first name. This fully operational engine has appeared in several motion pictures about railroading. In time, Americans became captivated by trains and railroads. People often would take short excursions just for the sheer joy of riding the rails. And so it was at Railfare 91 with old number 4466.
Well, at this railfare, it mainly pulled a passenger train between the Mort site and I-5 bridge and back. 4466 was one of 30 locomotives bought by Union Pacific in 1920. This one was out shopped in October 1920. And mainly used the yard switch engine, or a yard goat. This one last ran in Cheyenne. It was the passenger switch engine. It's an 060 wheel arrangement. And all the weight is on the drivers of the locomotive. It weighs 159,000 pounds. It's got 21 by 26 inch cylinders, a 21 inch bore and a 26 inch stroke. 4466 carries 4,500 gallons of water in its tender and six ton of coal. Those that missed it don't know what they missed.
Britons and Americans have always shared a love for trains. Two guest stars at Railfare 91 were born in England. One a workhorse and the other an excursion locomotive with a very special pedigree.
The locomotive is an 044 type with side tanks. It's coal-fired. It was built in 1895 in Scotland for the Duke of Sutherland for the private railway. It was built by Sharp and Stewart, and the purpose of the engine was for the operate the Duke's private train. This engine was never operated by a railway. In all its life, it was always in private custody. It's always been maintained. The Duke would come from his castle at Dunrobin down to the Highland Railway main line, where he would go down to Inverness, which is about 86 miles, and pick up his guests, and quite often this was royalty, and they would ride back on the train. Some would be invited to ride on the footplate, which in this case end up in that large leather seat in the back of the cab, and they would ride home to the castle, where they would be up for the shooting season for either grouse or deer or whatever else they happened to be wanting to bag at that time. It always has been coal fired. The boiler still carries 150 pounds of steam, which is what it was to carry when it was built. It has copper tubes, has a copper firebox, and a steel wrapper sheet. It is very unusual in one respect, in that it has wrought iron wheels, which are very, very scarce. A similar type of engine of this, same size, wheels, cylinders, and all that, used in local commuter or suburban service, would have no trouble hauling four or five of those little light wooden coaches about 50 to 60 miles an hour between stations. A snappy little engine, it really moves.
It works at 170 pounds to the square inch. It is a high evaporator, which means that it produces a lot of steam and hence is very powerful. Its job was to work in marshalling yards as a switch loco, I believe you call them here. And it also moved heavy freight trains between one region and the other, which means to say that it would only travel about 50 or probably as little as 30 miles on a journey, but would carry large loads. They were worked hard. They were workhorses, they were worked round the clock, and were invariably in a filthy condition. There was never any time for them to be clean. The success of the class is measured by the number that were built. There were 129 of them in all, of which this is the sole survivor.
You know, the Dunrobin was living pretty high on the hog for the Duke of Sutherland. But if he'd had a spread like this, he would have known what luxury living is all about. Speaking of spreads, the folks here at Railfare have done a pretty darn good job of it.
The California State Railroad Museum is an extraordinary institution. It's a part of the California Department of Parks and Recreation, 100,000 square foot facility containing 21 fully restored locomotives and cars, 40 interpretive exhibits covering the history and effects of railroading in California and the West. No force, with the possible exception of water, has shaped California like the railroad has. The railroad gave us the Golden State that we know and enjoy today. The railroad shaped the locations of our cities and towns, the jobs we have, our industries. It gave us agriculture. It was responsible for so much of what we take for granted today. Railfare 91 is the culmination of the efforts of hundreds of people over 2 years to put on an event which is unique. This is not aimed at the railroad enthusiast or the rail fan. This is an event for the general public, the people who have an appreciation for the railroad industry, but don't sit down by the tracks and take photographs of trains as they roll by or go out and count the rivets on the tender of a steam locomotive. If you look at the people with the infant in the stroller and the five-year-old by the hand, those aren't rail fans, those are people here experiencing for the first time or reliving an important aspect of American history and popular culture. We've brought together the largest concentration of historic railroad equipment that has occurred in this continent in perhaps 50 years.
We wanted to show people how the railroads touched everyone's life. Let's not just have a locomotive show. Let's have something that really shows people the cultural and economic impact that these machines had on their lives.
Sometimes railroaders tend to forget their importance in history, and I think getting them all together here and getting them with the public so the public could actually see, touch, feel the locomotives and feel that history, I think was really beneficial. And for the kids, they actually saw railroading. They saw real locomotives. They didn't just see pictures or HO models. They had those available too, but they actually got to see the locomotives that made the history. It was very exciting to be around all this equipment. It'll never happen again.
Thank you, Lewis. It's time for dessert, folks. Now let's take a look at some of my favorite engines, those huffin', puffin', choo-choo-in beauties who were first across this great country from sea to shining sea.
But the people of Sacramento were inquisitive and enthusiastic about the notion of an iron horse belching steam as it roared across the countryside. I began my survey the next day. Construction began early in 1855, and that 21-mile line to the new town of Folsom was completed 1 year later. At the opening celebration, Senator Flint told the assembled crowd they were witnessing the inauguration of a line that would span the continent and embrace the two oceans. My sentiments exactly.
Dramatic recreations were key attractions at Railfare 91, capturing the flavor of the times like the Gold Rush days. The railroad depot was the pulsing heart of the West, where great cargoes of goods and crowds of people were loaded and unloaded. Wood-burning stoves and treadle-operated sewing machines, mail and merchandise catalogs, relatives and mysterious strangers, the clamor and excitement of a circus, all merging at the depot, to the absolute delight of throngs of children gawking, enthralled by thundering steam locomotives. But these three were not recreations of Railfare 91. These were real participants in that historical period. The Inyo, the Eureka, and the Sierra Railway No. 3.
It's a 460, four lead wheel, six drivers, no trailing trucks. It's what they commonly called a 10-wheeler, that was the nickname. 150 pounds boiler pressure, its weight is about 50 tons.
Built in 1891 for the Prescott and Arizona Central Railroad, the Sierra Railway No. 3 was sold to the company of that name in 1897. Old No. 3 also became famous in the movies. She was the Hooterville Cannonball in the television series Petticoat Junction and co-starred with Michael J. Fox in Back to the Future 3. The state of California purchased No. 3 in 1982 as an operating attraction for Railtown 1897 State Historic Park.
Was originally named the Eureka, named after Eureka, Nevada. The engine ran on the Eureka and Palisade Railroad in central Nevada between 1875 and 1896. The engine weighs approximately 22 tons in working condition. That's an American 440 narrow gauge, of which there's only three left. This is the only operating one of the three.
Built in 1875, the Eureka hauled lead, silver ore, coal, and general merchandise throughout central Nevada. In 1939, it was sold to Warner Brothers Studios, and it, too, became a locomotive movie star, appearing in feature films like John Wayne's The Shootist, Finian's Rainbow, and many more.
Woodburner, built by Baldwin Locomotive Shops for the B&T Railroad to haul silver and gold down to Carson City.
The engine itself, empty,
weighs about 67,000 pounds.
arrangement on this is a 440, which means it has four pilot wheels and four drive wheels and no wheel in the truck area.
I'd like to stand back and just watch it roll by.
One of American history's great moments was the driving of the Golden Spike. This is the official portrait of the famous event, painted by Thomas Hill. It now hangs in the California State Railroad Museum. Guests at Railfair 91 were treated to a dramatic rendition of the occasion by this Irish lad.
Well, first of all, imagine yourself a-sitting there. Stanford gets back up to the toy. Now, he's no small man. So he grabbed that hammer. Oh, and with a mighty swing, he come down. He missed that tie altogether. Never hit the spike, he never hit the rail, he never hit nothing. Well, then, the hammer is handed to our own Mr. Durant. And I can't imagine what happened, for I know he's a better spike driver than Stanford. Of course, it could have been a wee bit of hangover he had from Agnew the night before. Whatever reason, the poor man feebly lifted the hammer, it feebly come down. And he missed the spike altogether. And finally, a regular rail worker grabbed the hammer, drove home the last spike, and the telegraph operator sent the message, done. And the greatest achievement in all the 1800s is completed.
And that's no blarney. If that Irishman was around today, he might even want his own train. Wouldn't you? How do you like this beauty? Let's go meet its owner, Bill Gardner.
We are probably the only one that has its own private train set with cars and locomotive. The complete train set of three cars took approximately 2 years to complete from start to finish. We actually searched out for three cars that we wanted to put together that would fit each car's own needs. The Northern View being a dome car, which we then converted into a dome lounge car. Then we had a sleeper, which is the second car that was built by the Union Pacific, and then we picked up a baggage postal storage car, which we then converted into Northern Plains.
The idea of owning a train like the Northern Pride is appealing, eh? But you don't think it'll fit in your driveway? How about this for a solution? This is the Eureka. Still a little big for the garage? We'll take a peek at the Sonoma. And it has all the bells and whistles of a real engine. In a small package.
I had to come down to the museum because there's no plans in existence, or there wasn't. I found some since, but at the time I was told there was no plans in existence. So I had to start taking measurements and tons of photographs of the prototype, and then go home and make drawings from that, and then build from my drawings. Consequently, I don't have an awful lot of finished drawings. Most of them are just what engineers would call a dimension sketch. But seeing I was the one who was going to build it from those drawings, I didn't need a fancy drawing. I built race cars fooled around with them since 1945, right after the war, I got bitten by the racing bug. When you build a race car, you're making everything as light as you possibly can. When you build a train, you make everything heavy. And that was a little difficult to get used to. You know, I kept thinking, maybe I can, I want something heavy, that's fine. I don't have to, don't cut a corner, use this. One of the neat things getting away from racing was there was no deadlines. I worked on this at my own pace when I wanted to, I wanted to do all I could, but there was no pressure. Then 8 months ago, got invited to Railfair, and then I had a deadline again.
Well, the gauge here is 15 inches, and it's been probably the most common gauge for amusement park miniature railroads, but most of them are built to a scale of 3 inches to the foot, and they result in some very small equipment. And we always felt that by going to narrow gauge proportions to a scale of 5 inches to the foot, we could get much larger equipment. And after some stability tests, we went to this gauge, and what you're seeing on this track here is all 5-inch scale. And we get a car that's big enough to put two adults side by side, which has been the goal for the commercial operations. We've set up a set of standards for this, and so when we gather this stuff together, why, everything fits. Coupler heights are the same, flanges are the same, so it
it's worked out to be a very attractive thing. It's still in its infancy, but it's a growing thing.
The 1915, the one-third scale engine, was made for the specific overfare rail line that they used in the Panama Pacific Exposition in San Francisco in 1915. It was never put together. We had to beg, borrow, and steal, and make whatever parts were necessary to make this whole. And it was extremely difficult to move it from the restoration shop over here into this lobby. As you can see, the lobby's carpeted and it has a very low ceiling. So it was pushed in just a few inches at a time.
Don't have time to slap one together in your garage? Then you might want to settle for this mini rail car. Looks just like a telephone booth, but it rides the rails just like its big brothers.
A motor car is small enough that an individual or a couple of friends can get together and they can put it on a trailer at a reasonable price, and we can tour 7 western states. It's unique to be able to ride long time and own something personally that you're personally responsible for, and you don't have to have a crew and spend many thousands of dollars for and only have it sit in your backyard. Okay. It's your own custom thing. You do it your way. You don't have to follow the plans of anybody else. Such as this one where we have the beacons and the horns on it. And we have other options that you can put on, and bells and all kinds of other things.
It ranges anywhere from a derelict one, maybe $500-$600, to about $1,300-$1,400 operable, like showroom condition. You want something that's reliable and fast, mm-hmm. and able to turn around quickly and get in the clear if you had to.
Why in the world would you want to turn around? Wait just a darn minute. This thing rides on the same track as the big trains.
We have train orders that says, we have exclusive use of this portion of track. If that train's there, he's wrong. Okay, so although we watch out for these things, he's in the wrong.
You say you don't relish a head-on meeting with an oncoming train? Then here's one you're sure to love, because it doesn't need a set of rails.
Well, this is a 1929 Graham Page, model 837. It was built by a fellow by the name of Harry McGee for Paramount Pictures, and they used the cars as VIP cars at their Publix theater chain, and they were used all over the United States. Kids should always have toys, and I never got my toy train when I was a kid, so when I grew up, I made up for it.
You know, traveling by train has always been one of the most pleasant ways to get from here to there, especially on a train like this. But most of the trains here at Railfare 91 have had to work very hard for their living.
No glamorous parlor car pullers here. No spit and polish prima donna. These were the unsung heroes of the rails. These stout-hearted chuggers hauled the heavy stuff. The cement, the lumber, the stone from the quarries that was building America. Abused and beat up, but uncomplaining, these sturdy workhorses helped build levees, homes, and highways, the towns and cities and nations of the world.
This locomotive, Gwen, was built in 1920 by the Hunslow Engine Company for the Knowles Company in Burton-on-Trent, England. And the Knowles Company was a manufacturer of refractory materials, including bricks and clay pipes. The locomotive joined its brother Jack. Jack locomotive was very similar to this one, built in 1898. Both locomotives worked hauling tubs of clay back and forth from the pit to the manufacturing plant until 1958.
These small locomotives were built between 1897 and 1920. They were used primarily to transport hopper-type wheel tubs loaded with fire clay ore between the open pit mine and a processing plant, which produced bricks and stoneware pipes. It was the last commercially built 18-inch gauge locomotive in the United Kingdom.
She sat basically in the wind and rain and storm for about 15, 20 years until we were able to get a hold of her in 1983 at an auction, and we've been restoring her since then.
Number 9 is a Climax logging locomotive. This one was built in 1915 in Corry, Pennsylvania. It spent the majority of its working life on Vancouver Island at Masachi Lake, and that's just about 40 miles northwest of Victoria, which is the capital of British Columbia in Canada.
The unique thing about this engine is its gear drive. All 8 wheels on this engine are powered, and therefore it has a great, tremendous traction, and it has been known to work on as much as a 9% grade.
Just 33-inch wheels, she's gear-driven. We think the ratio is somewhere around 3-to-1, we're not sure. Anything over 15 miles an hour, you start turning into the Lone Ranger riding a bucking bronco. You have to hang on.
Number 9 is the only known intact Climax locomotive in Canada, and one of less than 35 Climaxes remaining in the world.
151 is a 1918 Alco saddle tank with tender. It was originally built as a self-contained tank unit, but when Imperial Irrigation District bought it, brand new from Alco in the 20s, they put an old 1860s slope-back tender on it. They did that for the extra water capacity. It's about 32 tons without the tender. Top speed on a real good day with the tailwinds about 20, 25. It hauled rock on a quarry, out of a quarry on a levee line that built levees along the Colorado River, and it pulled about 10 to 15 rock cars, which were air dumped, air operated, which is why we have 2 air pumps and 2 reservoirs instead of just 1 of each. It's just a slobbering old dog. It just gets us here and back. Sort of the bathtub Nash of locomotives. You either hate it or you love it.
This Heisler engine was used to move marble out of the Phoenix Marble Company quarry until the mine closed in the early 1940s. A few years later, for a short time, train rides were offered near a shopping center using the locomotive to pull an old trolley car. In 1984, Marvin Kendall, M.D., found the engine near Springfield, Missouri, and began restoration work. Original parts were scattered throughout the United States. The number plate was found in New Jersey, and the side rods in a chicken coop in Arkansas. This engine is now fully operational.
The history of the locomotive was that it was owned by Thomas Edison originally and for the Edison Portland Cement Company in New Jersey. It was used in the cement plant to move cars back and forth to make up trains and so on. And it spent its time not doing glorious work at all.
This locomotive was built in 1892 by Marschutz and Cantrell, otherwise known as National Iron Works in San Francisco. It was operated on the Bear Harbor Lumber Company, operating from Bear Harbor in Mendocino County. It ran up the coast about 2 miles to about a 1,600-foot incline, and then over to Ridgetop from there to Moody and to Andersonia, which is just across the river from Piercy up in northern Mendocino County. It has a lap seam boiler, unfortunately, which means that the best we could do is 50 pounds on it. We might be able, if we were running an air compressor, we might be able to get the pressure up to 80 pounds, which would be sufficient. But under the present circumstances, we run it on 50 pounds, it'll do anything we want it to do.
Yes, sir, those were great machines that helped build this country. Without them, we might all be living in adobe huts, getting our water from wells, reading our books by candlelight. Hey, wait, what was that? I didn't see that one. Stop the tape and roll it back, please.
This little rail bus was built in 1932 by the Fairmont Railway Motor Company. It's powered by a Model A Ford, a double A transmission, and a double reversing rear end. It has its own jack, so it gets to the end of the run and everything. The operator can crank it up into the air, spin it around while it's all in the air, balanced on the jack, crank it back down, and run back the other way.
Gentlemen, we need a volunteer. Who's going to volunteer?
I'll help you.
All we take is a little Norwegian steam. You want to try and turn this thing around by yourself? All right. You know this is a real job now.
This vehicle weighs about 6,000 pounds. It's not a lightweight. It has a four-speed transmission, four speeds forward and one reverse, or with another lever, four speeds reverse and one forward. It's the call the operator's decision whether or not he wanted a stiff neck or not.
Yes, sir, those were great machines that helped build this country. Without them, we might all be living in adobe huts, getting our water from wells, reading our books by candlelight. Restoring these handsome locomotives to their original freshness and transporting them to Railfare 91 took the time, energy, skill, and dedication of hundreds of people, most of them volunteers. And attached to every polished, shiny steam engine is the story of a rusted hulk of steel that became a family member in the households of the restorers, a welcome but troublesome boarder, a guest who would not leave.
These can be frustrating machines. These are objects that require a tremendous amount of attention, can be quite demanding. You can't just go down to the auto parts store and get what you need to repair one of these things.
This is probably one of the crankiest, most idiosyncratic, most cantankerous machines here at Railfare.
Something just captures you, and it's very hard to put your finger on it. It's very hard to stand and have a conversation with someone and explain the emotional, it's almost a kind of spiritual attachment, I guess, that you develop with these machines.
We have a number of these things vying for the title of most curmudgeonly locomotives.
At Aunt Tilly's birthday party, becomes very low on the totem pole when it comes to taking care of one of these monsters.
I'm going to nominate Tom Thumb as the one with the most abjectly miserable personality.
It cost about $2,500 in cash out of the pocket, $15,000 in donations of equipment and services, two marriages, one relationship, and assorted fingers and knuckles and such.
It knows that I could make it into a couple of Toyotas in very short order. I know that it could blow me to bits.
You get into a panic for doing certain things, and all of a sudden everybody's blaming everybody else who's working on the thing.
I'm the guy 100 guys' wives who's very angry at me.
Now there is a lot of hard work and a lot of dirty work. I mean, this is not a gravy train.
I said part-time. My wife might have thought it was full-time.
If you don't have it in pretty good shape on the domestic scene there, as far as a project like this, you're done before you even start it.
Those guys devoted 4,000 man hours and three divorces, and they got the locomotive restored and back on the road.
They've always told me that you weren't a good railroad man until you've been married and divorced three times.
Between the two of us, we've reached a kind of a cosmic synergy here. It doesn't blow me up, I don't scrap it, and we hope to go through life and have a long and happy association.
It's a regular camaraderie of people that come out here and work on these things.
Preserving old locomotives or working on one is not a rational act.
Well, I think they're all nuts.
You'll work and you work and you work, and it seems like nothing's happening. Then all of a sudden, one day, boom, things start happening and it starts going back together.
It's a very special person to put in that time and commitment, but at the same time, it offers a lot of people an opportunity to see something that just is not available. I'm lost for the word to describe them because I don't know that there is one.
That's about the only way you can get along with these machines. They live, they breathe, they have personalities, not always good ones, which is why I find myself in the ballast, in the mud, at a place like this, enjoying every minute of it.
Railfare 91 would have been incomplete without a salute to the diesel-electric engines, those oil-burning behemoths introduced in the 1930s, which gradually replaced the steam-powered locomotives and changed forever the character of railroading. Frequently referred to as the diesel that revolutionized railroading in America, the number 103 traveled over 83,700 miles of test and demonstration runs between November 1939 and October 1940. This 2,700 horsepower locomotive was intended to compete with the finest in steam locomotive technology. FT number 103 was sold to the Southern Railway and operated on many of its subsidiary lines before its retirement in 1960.
Santa Fe's newest locomotive was built in October of 1990. It's a 4,000 horsepower diesel-electric locomotive, carries 3,000 gallons of fuel, costs $1.3 million, and we use them on our super fleet trains between Chicago and Los Angeles and Chicago and Richmond, California, on our 70-mile-an-hour intermodal piggyback trains. It has a 16-cylinder, four-cycle, 4,000 horsepower turbocharged diesel engine in it. This is the latest state-of-the-art. It has computer control on it. It has the latest traction motors on it. Computers control the engine. The engineer still operates the train.
This is the Union Pacific 6936, and it's one of the largest diesel locomotives ever built. The 6936 is two locomotives on one frame. Each locomotive is 3,300 horsepower for a total of 6,600. The first one was built in 1969. And it was one of the real high-tech engines of the time, and I'm thrilled to death to be driving this at Railfare.
This is the reverser lever. It's like the key to the locomotive. Okay, we're ready to operate. You ready, Red?
Ready, Kirk. Let's go, over.
Hold your ears. Bell down here.
So, now you've seen how a diesel engine operates. Push a button here, pull a lever there, it all looks very easy. But making a steam locomotive roll is something else again. Just a wee bit more complicated. Let's take a look at how it's done, in the event you ever have to take your turn at the throttle.
After having done it for 41 years, I don't think that there's anything hard about it. There is certain idiosyncrasies of a steam locomotive that you don't have on a diesel.
Well, you know, all locomotives were named after women.
Hello.
They're very temperamental.
Temperamental?
Today it seems beautiful, tomorrow, no. Maybe that afternoon, everything goes to pot.
I'm not the one moving the levers. If you can't stand the heat, you better get out the kitchen.
They all have a throttle, they all have a forward and reverse mechanism, and they all have brakes. They all have a method of putting water in a boiler, and of course, they all have to have fuel of some type to create the steam pressure.
This is a wood-fired locomotive. And we throw the wood in here. It's just like a fireplace in the house. Throw it in there, keep all the grates covered. And that heats up your water in your boiler. And then we got your temperature gauge up here. This gives you an idea of what your temperature is. You inject water into here. When after your water turns to steam, you lose your water going through the system. And you inject it right here. Similar to that. And my job is to keep the fire going, keep the pressure up, and keep plenty of water in the boiler. And if you lose water in the boiler, you're gonna have an explosion more than likely.
Quick, put the water in! Put the water in!
We have in the side of the boiler a piece of steel that's referred to as the crown sheet. Under the crown sheet is this tremendous fire. On top of the crown sheet is water. And that sheet has to have the water on the back side of it to keep it from turning bright red. If it becomes bright red, it becomes soft, and the steam pressure will collapse the sheet. And of course, at that point, you have an explosion.
So you have to keep water in the boiler. And we test this glass by blowing down.
I'm so thirsty.
It clears the glass to make sure the system is correct, and the water bounces back to the level that we want it at.
You keep the water where it belongs. Keep a couple inches in the glass, or like going over the mountains, if you're going in the hill country, then you got to keep it to high water.
Up no hill, baby.
So then when the engine tops a rise, why, if you're going downhill, the water sloshes towards the front of the boiler and you don't want to expose the rear crown sheet because you don't take long and it's either warped or it's coming apart.
Up here we have what we call a lubricator. This lubricates the system. It injects valve oil into the system with the steam, and it lubricates all the moving parts so you don't have dry parts that wear out.
You might get a flue or two plug up and front end plug up, and you're not going to get anything. You're going to have to stop, open it up, and scoop that front end out and clean it all out, and then go again.
Johnson bar basically is your forward and reverse in an engine. That's forward, and you pull it back for reverse, and then this is in neutral, called the Johnson bar. Then you have your throttle up here. Once you put your Johnson bar into position, you toot the whistle that you're moving forward with two blasts.
I'm out of here.
Then you look around, forward and back, make sure everything's clear. And then you pull the throttle and it starts taking off.
Like I need you. I run on rails, honey.
You've got a brake up here. This is your engine brake. Then you apply your brake. You let off. And it locks in. This is the brake release. Here is your tricox. This is how the engineer checks the water level. You should have steam coming out of this one. The water level should be probably right about here. Should have steam coming out of this one and a little bit of water dribbling out of this and water dribbling out of the bottom one. And if you don't, you're in trouble because you've lost your water and then the crown sheet gets hot and it flashes and boom, you're gone.
I like to scare him sometimes.
They're like an automobile. No two people drive an automobile the same. You might be the best fireman in the world. Next thing you know, I come along and I can't get it to do anything.
I was perfectly fine before you came along.
Hey. Maybe it don't like me.
Oh, honey, I like you. I'm just playing hard to get is all.
But it's just one of those things.
Boss can't read, boss can't write. How can he tell when the track ain't right? Boss can't read, boss can't write. How can he tell when the track ain't right? Boss can't read, how, oh yeah.
Visitors to Railfare 91 were treated to a dazzling array of entertainment from dawn to dusk. It was showtime, excitement, carnival, railfare time.
Eyes down by the river on my knees in prayer. When the devil come around and he caught me there, he said, who boy? I got you now, who boy? I said, stand back, Satan, don't you do me no wrong. I'm a child of God, and I'm singing a song in praise of him. Glory, hallelujah. And I say, thank you, Lord, Lord. Thank you, Lord, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for letting me sing tonight. Thank you, Lord, Lord. Thank you, Lord, Lord.
Thank you, Lord, Lord.
I'm reading up on the superstars of rail fare, famous names like the Challenger, the Daylight, and the Union Pacific 844. We're lucky enough here at Rail Fare 91 to have some of the few remaining examples of those big, powerful, beautiful giants that roared along the rails shouting out the freedom and spirit of America.
Thinking about things that we really ought to be doing in our life, we decided that this engine needed to run again. And that's when we decided to go ahead and do what we did. We restored the engine and then brought it out here for rail fare. It was its first big trip in 1981.
That's the last new steam engine the Union Pacific bought. It's never been retired, it's never been restored, it's been in service since it was built in December of 44. It's the premier passenger engine in the country. We've had it in special service now for 31 years. Tremendous locomotive, it's known around the world. These are the flagships of the Union Pacific, and they indicate a lot of corporate pride and a lot of employee pride.
3985 was designed in 1943 when it was built to pull troop trains during the war effort.
The 844 was designed for fast passenger service, 90 miles an hour with 26 cars, and it can still do that. The 3985, the world's largest operating steam locomotive. It and the 844 are sisters, and they make a good match.
Across the wind.
Built in 1941 for the Southern Pacific, it pulled the famous daylight trains between San Francisco and Los Angeles. It was used by the Southern Pacific until 1957 when it was donated to the city of Portland, Oregon, where it went into a park there, just like many other park engines in the country. 1974, it was taken out of the park for use on the American Freedom Train to celebrate this nation's bicentennial, and has been kept in sort of regular service since then to be used on special occasions.
Baldwin Locomotive Company for the Southern Pacific Railroad. The locomotive was designed to pull the San Francisco Overland Limited, America's version of the Orient Express, and it did that from Sparks, Nevada to Ogden, Utah. That was a distance of 535 miles. At the time, that was the longest unassisted run by a steam locomotive in the world, a record that remained for quite a few years.
Take the engine around for people to see it, we decided it was time to convert it to oil. And for a test run, we tied on to 143 cars, double stack container train, had no problems, it walked right off of the train. They used to estimate it to be 5,000 horsepower, but I think their estimates were wrong because we took 20,000 horsepower off and put our steam engine on and walked away with the train.
We're like zookeepers for dinosaurs, we're perpetuating a lost art. These are our lost skills and lost experiences. And we think it's a piece of history and we're all glad to be part of it. You know, every moment of running this engine is special. We have to work on this locomotive 100 hours for every hour that we run it. It has to be a labor of love. This is something you can't pay somebody to do.
The project to restore the locomotive 2472 began in 1975. This is a 16-year restoration effort by many men and women of various backgrounds. But I have to tell you, the volunteers that we have are really dedicated people, because what we had to go through in that fairgrounds was just beyond compare. The entire locomotive's restored in a parking lot, for crying out loud.
It's a hobby that is hard to share with somebody else. It's a relationship that you have with the machine, and every moment is special on the thing when you run it. That's why you do what you do.
Most people in the country today have never seen a live steam locomotive. They don't even know such things exist. And we run ours all around the western United States and bring a lot of joy to everybody. We're like Santa Claus.
City's clean, undimmed by human Well, this has been a heck of an experience, but now I'm really going to have some fun. Bill's going to let me take this baby home. Oh, this has been fun, but I forgot to close the show. I better get to the back of the train and say goodbye and wave goodbye. Oh, this has been quite an experience. Oh, gotta hurry. What a nice guy to let me use the train. That Bill Gardner's all right in my book. I'll vote for him. No, wait, I want him to vote for me.
Oop, excuse me, folks. Pardon me. Oop, gotta get through. In a hurry. Excuse me. Rail fare business. I got a speech to give you. One more than I said. I got it.
I'll see you at the next rail fare. And remember, friends, a vote for me is a vote for you. A chicken in every pot and a Ford in every garage.
Life is like a mountain railway with an engineer who's brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curve that fills the tunnels. Never falter, never fail. Keep your hand on the throttle and your eye on the rail. Blessed Savior, lead and guide us till we reach that promised shore, where the angels wait to join us in God's grace forevermore. In God's grace forevermore.